And so I chose David Hawkins' Power Versus Force, Levels of Consciousness and Kinesiology to translate. And sure enough, if you go onto Amazon and look at the 25 books I got in print, his book is always number one. And this is 6 years in print now. The Japanese, very, very smart. They figured out, okay, let's go into this. Let's look into kinesiology. Let's look into levels of consciousness and how they relate to power and force. And in a nutshell, what he was saying in that, it was a PhD dissertation, actually, Power Versus Force. What he was saying very simply was that an individual like Mother Teresa or Mahatma Gandhi has a level of consciousness of between 700 and 800 on a scale of 0 to 1,000. The British Empire, at its height, had a level of consciousness below 200, which is the threshold for an evolutionary upward movement, right? And so that it would explain why a guy in a dhoti with half of his teeth missing and spectacles that hardly work, bare feet, can overcome the British Empire. One guy. So there is no question that the force being applied through technology like HARP, through the BP informational shutdown surrounding the Gulf situation, 9/11, you name it, it's pathetically inadequate to deal with the level of consciousness that we are now making contact with. And so we need to feel sorry for people who think that they can shut this down. It's hilarious.
Oh yeah. Yeah. It's amazing. You know, all they're doing is accelerating their own karma, which is going to come back in their face very fast. What I see is that this compression that happens, you know, the Mayans talk about it, how we're going to go through a huge amount of time in just a very short space of evolution, you might say, time starts collapsing.
Indeed.
And the way I see it, and, you know, it could be wrong, I don't know, but I see it as that everything is going to be accelerated. You know, whatever thoughts you're holding, whatever you're carrying in your bands or in your fields is going to be amplified, and you know, we do are carrying guilt and things, even though we think we've fooled other people, we haven't fooled ourselves. And all that's going to be amplified, accelerated, and you know, no rock will be left unturned. The truth is going to come forward, as well as the karmic reaction to what we've put out there. And I do. I feel sorry for these people that have chosen that path.
Well, what you've just said was extremely pointed, because in the last year, I have personally gone through a great deal of meltdown, shift, painful realization of how much karma I have been carrying around in this life form. And I haven't been able to escape from one iota of it. And I don't see how anybody else will be able to either. In the old days, let's say 50 years ago, let's say 100 years ago, you could hatch a plot like 9/11 and you could get away with it for 500 years.
Oh, yeah.
Because that's just the way that the time-space continuum dealt with the informational process, right? It took that long for people to find out. But you said if you're right in your understanding of fractal compression, you could be wrong. I don't think you're wrong. I think that any sane, intelligent, aware, and awake human being has to admit and realize that we are undergoing fractal time compression, which means what? It means that more and more will be happening in less and less of a time, and it will be getting closer and closer to the real heart of the issue, which is what? It is your own spiritual reality. And so if you've got some issues, they are absolutely going to come to the fore. It's just a matter of time, literally. And one does feel sorry for those who believe that things can be covered up forever and that you can get away with murder, because you can't. Until now, maybe, but not from now on.
No.
So we're all in the same thing together, and we're all equally challenged. And it humbles one. It really does, to think, wow, if it's this intense now, what's it going to be like around about 2012? Even for me, it's hard to imagine, James.
Well, I think about these people with these vast empires, you know, and they've got control of so many people, you know, underneath them. And basically they're totally imprisoned by that because their move depends on the people beneath them, you know, where they're going. But,
yes.
You know, they'd be so much better off barefoot and in the jungle, you know, than in the position they are, you know. But I know that most of them are very, you know, narcissistic and you know, they have these just massive egos. They'll never figure this one out, but... when things hit the fan, you know, the people that are going to fare best are the people that are living simple and know how to make do with whatever's around them. You know, all these massive empires are going to crash, and the people that are willing participants in a lot of these programs that are harmful to humanity, Earth, you know, the simple people that are just hanging out and being kind to each other are just going to probably ride this right on through.
Well, that brings us back to the film. The main part of Earth Pilgrims is shot at an altitude of approximately 16,000 feet in the Peruvian Andes. And there, every year, for the last maybe several millennia, the indigenous population, the Quechua-speaking Peruvian people from all over the country, congregate at the base of a glacier in the Sinacara Valley for a festival which is called the Snow Star Festival. In their language, it is Coyuriti. The star that they're referring to in the Sun Star Festival, they call the Eternal Star. Now, they don't refer to it by a name that we might recognize in astronomy, but I have a strong suspicion about what this star might be.
Mm-hmm.
What they do is they pray and dance for 3 days, 3 nights, 4 days, 60,000 people gathering here, dirt poor people. I mean,
mm-hmm.
people who have nothing, and you were referring earlier to it's people like this that are going to be able to help us. I couldn't agree with you more. That's why they are the real heroes of this film. 60,000 people who, against all odds, have dragged themselves from their villages at high expense to them to get on buses. They've taken their crosses because it's now, of course, a Catholic festival. It was originally an indigenous shamanic festival that
mm-hmm.
changed. It was Christianized. But as Wade Davis beautifully told us in his interview, you know, they have fused a shamanic tradition with a Christian tradition. They don't know where one starts and where the other ends. It doesn't matter. They're praying to something very high. They're dancing. They're imploring the earth to respond to their heartfelt prayers of, please support us for another year. Please give us another harvest. This is called Aini, reciprocal maintenance between the human and the environmental communication. So I spent that time up there with these people who have nothing. You can hardly breathe up there. And they are dancing and singing their hearts out. And at the penultimate moment, on the third day, when the rays of the sun hit the crosses which are set up on the glaciers, it was like that moment in Close Encounters. It really was, where they all stop, the door opens, and something comes out, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, what happened with us was that everybody stopped. They realized it's come. The spirit has just arrived. 60,000 people have invited the spirit, and it came. It washed over us all. This light, this amazing energy came from the top of the mountain. And I realized, aha, that's what we're heading into. That's what we're moving into.
Mm-hmm.
And these people know it. These people have always known it. And these are the kind of people I want to be with when that happens. Because they know how to celebrate. They know how to sing. And they know how to respond. I would not like to be in Tokyo when that happens, which is why, with all due respect and love for my host country, Japan, I am now in the deep mountains of British Columbia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I understand that one. I'm pretty high up in the mountains in Washington State right now.
Oh, you're just down the road from us.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, we're having some pretty. You have to come to the ranch here sometime. It's a vortex. It's just a real high energy place where the veils collapse, and we have masters appearing here and actually being photographed.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's amazing. We've had Kuan Yin appear here. We've had Mary appear here. Beautiful photographs of her in some of the ceremonies. We've had feline beings that are like 12 feet tall.
Feline beings 12 feet tall. I'm interested in those now. Tell me more about those.
Yeah, we've actually photographed these beings, and they're from Sirius. And when I first contacted these beings, I thought I was going Looney Tunes, and I started doing a research on them. And I found out that, you know, in India they called them Narsringa, and they were the benevolent protectors. And then they're all throughout Egyptian lore, you know, as Sekhmet and is it Bas?
Oh, my goodness.
Or, I can't remember who it is. But these beings do exist, and they're extremely advanced beings. You know, they're fifth and sixth dimensional beings. So it was pretty interesting that other people I found are having the same experience, but they seem to be only contacting people that are very far along in their evolution, that aren't going to be, you know, throwing fear and
Well, you're giving me the heebie-jeebies here, James, because when you see our film, and I'll make sure that you get a copy sent to you, I'll make sure of this, you will see that at the very first thing that comes up at the beginning of Earth Pilgrims is our Rainbow Jaguars film.
Uh-huh.
The Rainbow Jaguars are those beings that you have just described, Syrian, which Murray Hope, one of the great Syrian contactees, a British psychic, she called them the Pashats, P-A-S-C-H-A-T-S. Of course, in the Egyptian tradition, it was, among others, it was Sekhmet.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, I'm writing about this right now in a novel called The Japanthropologist, which is all about Japan's connection to 2012, but does contain information about Sekhmet, mm-hmm, and about how the Egyptians really did contact these, as you correctly noted, very highly evolved beings who just happened to be in a feline form. And, you know, we're so human-centric. We think that Homo sapiens is the ultimate, but, you know, I've got a cat sitting next to me now licking her body, and it's pretty obvious to all cat lovers that there's a different kind of intelligence and beauty and elegance at work in the universe, and it's in a cat form.
Oh, yeah.
So when you get to Peru, it becomes a jaguar.
Have you met Khan by any chance over in Japan? He's a Japanese monk.
Khan? Well, there are many Japanese monks I've met. Now, tell me more about him.
Well, he comes here and he teaches classes, you know, in Yigong and Kunlun and things of that nature. And he's bilocating all over the place, having some pretty amazing experiences. But he actually came here and he photographed Kuan Yin appearing in our field, in our front field.
My goodness. My goodness.
Then I asked him Kazekiel, which is an ascended form of Ezekiel who merged with a feminine energy by the name of Kasiya and ascended. I asked him, can you meditate on Kazekiel, which is just a pure golden energy, and see if you can get a photograph? It can take a form. So he did, and it appeared to him, and he took a photograph, and there's this brilliant gold-white ball of energy with wings on it. And you look in the background, and there's a city like Jerusalem or something in the background, like a crystalline city. But he took it in a field where there's nothing. There's nothing there, you know. So he, like, opened up a dimension on that one.